In this segment, we are going to be talking about how to install half-inch copper potable water piping. Okay, the first step we're going to talk about is safety. And remember, the temperatures of soldering copper pipe using MAP gas can reach up to 2400 degrees Fahrenheit. So wear some nice, these are cotton gloves. Do not use plastic gloves, of course, because they'll melt right to your hand. So nice pair of cotton gloves. Always safety glasses in any type of construction. Wear your safety glasses, and I always keep a rag because the flux gets hot that we use to prepare the fitting, and have a rag to wipe that. It's very hot, and if it touches your skin, you will be burned. Okay, we've covered safety. Next step is make sure you have all the materials and tools you'll need for the project. First thing you're going to need is some type of tubing cutter. This is a standard one. It ratchets and then you finally fine-tune it at the end to cut. You need a pencil reamer. This is after you cut the pipe. You need to make sure the pipe is enlarged to the full bore. You need some type of crocus cloth to clean the outside of the pipe. You need a correct size fitting brush to the size of the fittings you have. These are half inch. This is a half inch fitting brush. Goes in tightly to clean the fitting. Instead of using the crocus cloth, you can also, with one of these brightening cloths, a lot easier to use. Either one is fine. And then as far as materials, you'll need a good flux to prepare the joint and pipe. You'll need lead-free solder. Definitely lead-free after flint. It's actually outlawed to have lead in your pipe, in your solder. Let's see, as far as drilling, I use a good clutch drill that if it hits a nail or something that's unforeseen, it'll kick off. You've got to have a good planter bit, a paddle bit like this, to the correct size. Make sure your bit size, when these are isolators that keep the pipe from rattling in the hole and prevent the pipe from touching the wood, which could create noise during expansion and contraction of the pipe. Make sure your drill bit matches it. This is 1 3/8 is the standard. This type of insulator is requires 1 3/8 holes. So make sure you have the right size bit for your isolators. And then we have two types of torches. This one is the one that I always use. It's MAP gas. Most of you home enthusiasts may be using propane, which burns at a lower temperature and takes longer to execute the soldering process. So I recommend getting a turbo torch, a MAP gas type torch. It burns hotter, you'll get the job done, have much more control of what you're doing. Of course, before you start, also tools you want to have, in addition to what we've already talked about, is a good tape measure and a construction pencil so you can mark the wood before we drill it. Okay, when the first thing we're going to do is decide where we need to install this copper pipe. It depends on what fixture you're running the water supply to. Where you want to keep in mind is sheetrock's going to go on possibly both sides of this wall when we're finished. So you don't want the sheetrock nails or screws going into your pipe. So you'll want to be in the middle of the wood. Now, if you're going to have a waistline coming up and breaking over, they can be up to a 2-inch waistline, and then you're going to have to really allow to move your waters forward or backwards to allow for this large pipe to be in this area so you can cross them in the wall. But in this instance, for this demonstration purpose, we're just going to place it in the middle of the 2x4 plate. I'm roughly going to be in the middle, so it's a 3.5 inch plate, so 1 3/4. And then we're going to offset and go through this stud. We want to be exactly the same because the pipe, we don't want to be awkwardly bending the pipe. So still 1 3/4 measured from the same side. Accuracy does count. Okay. Now we're also going to drill across. So we want this height to be the same as the other one. And we're just about 14 7/8. So take your time, measure. Prior to any drilling, take your tape measure and pencil and lay out your holes and be consistent on how far in to center, because if you don't and these you have to bend the pipe or it's kind of awkward, you will look like a hack. So I'm making sure that all my holes are correct and in line. Not only from the front end, also height. This is not drainage pipe, we're not grading. Now that we've correctly and carefully laid out the holes that we want to run the copper pipe through, we'll use this is called a right angle drill. This one has a clutch on it. For this size bit though, I'm not going to use the clutch. I want to drill at a higher RPM. It has 300 RPM and it has 1200. I'm going to be using the 1200 RPM. And before you start, make sure your bit is sharp. We're not going to take the time to show you how to sharpen a bit. That's a whole nother module. So make sure your bits are in good shape. Otherwise, you will never get through. And your wood. There's also a factor in the wood. If the wood is green, which means it's recently cut and wet, the bit probably will not cut through it very well. So you want fairly dried wood. If not, you're going to be spending a lot of effort. So I take my time, I locate the worm bit right over the mark, brace myself so I can control this thing. Before you start to drill, make sure there's no nails coming through, especially where at this junction here of the stud and the plate, you know there's nails coming through to a certain height, so you do not want to drill where there are nails. We'll drill the sideways, the horizontal hole now. Now that we've got our holes correctly drilled, we will now proceed to pipe preparation and assembly. Let's make sure before we start that we have all the materials required before we prep. This is a strapping bar. I'm going to bring the copper pipe up through this hole, then put a T and take it through this stud, and then continue up, and then we'll have an outlet that will come through the sheetrock into the room for the fixture. And this is the strapping bar. There's many different varieties of these, but this one can handle 3/4 pipe and 1/2 inch pipe and 1 inch pipe. And the pipe fits through and solders to this strapping bar. That's why the strapping bar is in copper. There's many varieties of this type of part. So first thing we're going to do is I'm just going to cut a random piece of pipe that's going to be coming from below the floor up to roughly where my first tee is going to be. I'm going to then have this piece come through, and we're going to tee here, then we're going to continue up and then stub out of the wall. So when you've ready to cut the pipe using your cutter, now you can also do a hacksaw, but make sure your cut is perpendicular to the run of the pipe. You need a nice flush pipe so that when we insert the pipe into our fitting, we get full insertion. If you have an angled cut, you're not going to get full insertion and your joint will be weaker. Using a tubing cutter is, you just can't be a gorilla with this thing. You have to, let's get my rough measurement here, about how high I want it. Okay, that'll work. So our first cut could be roughly there. So this has a ratchet type slotter, goes in, and I just gently press it against the pipe, and then I turn the knob, the tightening knob, roughly just so it contacts and is snug in there, okay? Easily rolls, okay? You do not want to go hard because these wheels are very thin and you can easily break that wheel, and very expensive to replace, and just, you don't want to do it in the middle of your job. So just take your time. You just do maybe a 16th of a turn, go around once, each turn, slightly turning that, no more than a 16th of a turn. Very easy. Do not try to race through this because you will damage that wheel. That wasn't good. You do not want to drop your pipe onto the ground because you could dent that, the edge, and you want a perfect nice cut. If you drop any pipe, make sure that you haven't damaged and closed down the ID. If you need to, you'll have to recut to get a fresh piece of pipe and have the correct bore. Gently ratchet and shove the cutting wheel snugly against the pipe. Then as you go around slowly, about a 16th of a turn on the cutting wheel to get started. If you go harder than that, you take a chance, a risk damaging your cutting wheel. And you will be sorry if you do that. If you break off, that wheel is very fragile. So take your time going around. It may seem excessive, but you do not want to be a gorilla with this thing. It'll eventually cut itself through a nice, perfect cut all the way around without damaging the pipe. Now, the effect of the wheel actually does slightly build up an inside shoulder on the end of that pipe. So, as we showed in the beginning, you'll take your reamer, in this case the pencil reamer, holding the pipe, and go around the inside, and you see it takes off and restores the pipe to its full inside diameter. Make sure you remove any chips that might have, you don't want those to stay inside, because it'll, when you finally connect to your fixture, you'll block up the aerator strainer. Okay, now after we've successfully cut and reamed our pipe pieces, we'll want to prepare the ends and the fittings to be flexed up. So we, again, at the beginning we talked about two different methods to be able to clean the pipe. So what we're doing is cleaning off oxidation off the pipe, and a lot of times during the formation of a pipe there'll be what we call grease marks where the rollers, and they'll leave something, it just looks like a black line on there, and that's enough to prevent the solder from adhering at that spot. So make sure that you've cleaned the ends where the fittings are going to go. Okay, so now that we've cut and reamed the ends of the pipes, we need to clean the outside part of the pipe to remove any grease or dirt or corrosion that has occurred before our installation. And you can use either the sandpaper or a crocus cloth. So we want to just clean it so it's shiny and consistent. None of the formation lines that are used during the process of making the pipe. Make sure that it's pure copper all the way around. We're going to do each end of the pipe where there's a fitting. Okay, now that we've prepared and cleaned the pipe, we've reamed it inside, we've taken our sand cloth and cleaned the outside ends of the pipe, we will clean the fittings. Eventually, you will clean all the fittings you're going to use. Remember, on the 90, take your correct size fitting brush, a few turns in there, visually inspect that there's no grease mark in there or any formation lines that would have gotten in there. Anything that's going to prevent the solder from adhering to the copper. Just a couple turns. These fittings don't need to be reamed like the pipe because we haven't cut them to constrict their inside diameter. Take the extra time to visually inspect after you clean them to make sure that you have got out anything that would cause a leak, because it'll save you a lot of grief and heartache having to disassemble a soldered pipe. Okay, now that we've cut and prepared all our pipe and fittings, we're ready to assemble. And it's like an erector set or anything, you're going to start at one end and work toward the other. The first one we're going to do will be our starting point right here. I'm going to start with my riser coming up through the floor plate, and I'm going to use my isolator, which will actually help locate this pipe and hold it in place while I'm working. So it has a split on it, on the isolator, allows me to spread and come across, so I don't need to start at the end. And then you can push these in if you've got the correct hole. If not, we can use the hammer to drive it in, and you can see the pipe is held fairly snugly until we get this exact elevation here. Okay, now that we've got our first two pieces in, we're ready to actually install our first fitting. This is a T because we're going to continue up and then out. So we need our flux now that prepares the pipe, and this one comes with its own flux brush. You may have to buy separate flux brushes depending on the type of flux you have. Okay, so we're going to apply the flux both the outside of the pipe that we're going onto and the inside of the fitting. This way, any little marks that or anything, this is a non-corrosive cleaning flux. So all the way around consistently. But just the length of the insertion, which is about 3/8 to 1/2 inch insertion of the fitting, depending on the size of your pipe and fitting. So you can see I'm preparing both the pipe and we prepared all of the fitting. The first tee, so of course, this is rather easy because both ends of the pipe are loose. As we can see, we need to adjust this in a little bit. We want to make sure you're plumb, and this is plumb here, and make sure we have full insertion. At this point, when we install this fitting, I'll use this last piece to indicate that you want to make sure you have full insertion. So if you have any worries, make just a slight pencil mark there. And we make sure it seats all the way down. And give it about a quarter turn to make sure you spread that flux. Okay? We'll fully seat this one and this one after we finish soldering. Just in case, it's a lot easier to move the pipe if we have to make slight adjustments before you seat these completely. Okay, now that we've got our first fitting in, at this point, before we go any further, we want to make sure our pipe is level and squared up with our framing, that it looks visually good. You can use a level. Make sure your framing's level, and then make sure your pipe matches that. Okay, we're completing our assembly, our little mock-up here. The 90 goes on. Make sure we got full insertion. We visually square up. Then this piece will go on. I'm not going to install this one at this point because I want to be able to demonstrate the soldering, but you would have this, and then using the nail holes on your 16-inch center studs or whatever you need to accomplish, level this out for visual looks, and then afterwards we'll put a cap on the end of the pipe for testing. And you want to leave your water lines pressurized while the sheetrockers are installing their work. In case they hit the line, we'll know immediately and not have to find out when it's really expensive to repair. Okay, so now we've completed our assembly, and as you can see, as we assembled this pipe, a lot of excess flux squirted out as we assembled. So we want to wipe off that excess. What happens as we heat it, that'll form a streak down the pipe and the solder will follow wherever that flux is. So take a moment, take your rag, gently wipe, making sure you're not disassembling the pipe, making sure you have full insertions. I always triple check, make sure I'm tight on all my fittings. Now I'm finishing wiping off, so let the flames begin. So now we're ready to begin our soldering. We first need to get the torch set at the proper flame level. So each torch is going to be different, but typically, you can see this, you don't want to blow the flame off like that. We've lost shape. You want to bring it down so you can see the fine points of the blue, but we don't want it so low what'll cause excessive heating of the tip at this level. So we want to move the flame out probably about, if you use 3 times the diameter of the orifice of your tip is approximately correct. Okay, this is too low. This is going to turn that tip cherry red. We don't want that. And this is too high. We're blowing the flame off. We don't have an accurate soldering point. So we want to bring it right in. So roughly the distance from the end of the tip out is about 3 times that orifice, the end of my tip. So right about there. Now we're ready to start soldering. The whole point of soldering is we are going to be entering the solder from the end of the joint, and the solder will want to travel to where the heat is. So we're going to want to be putting the flame at the top of the insertion, and we need to do that all the way around 360 degrees. So you actually preheat the fitting, and you also need to preheat the pipe slightly. So we're going to put some flame on the pipe. Okay, now this upper joint, heat rises. So as we're working on this joint, this one's already preheating, so we don't need to do excessive preheating of this upper joint. And this side joint is above this one, so we'll start on the lower one. The heat will rise and this will get pre-warmed. But again, we do want to make sure the pipe has some pre-warming to it, and then when we go to solder, we're going to be putting the flame right at the bottom of each insertion point. We want to preheat the pipe slightly, then we're going to heat, the destination of putting the solder in here will rise up to this where that it's being heated. So we preheat all three of the pipe, and then we start using our flame in 360 degrees all the way around each joint as we move up. And as heat's rising, we need to use less and less heat because this has already been preheated above it. So we'll now solder. So let's begin our soldering. Make sure you have your wiping cloth available. Okay, we're going to preheat the pipe first. I usually have my solder out about 8 to 10 inches, ready to go. You don't want to have it close to your fingers. Again, this flame is 2400 degrees. Okay, so we preheated the pipe. Now we want to preheat where we want the solder to go, up to that joint there. All right, so we preheat all the way around. We work from the bottom up because heat rises. And we can see that the solder becomes liquid and is drawn up. There, I've got a little bit on the back side. Okay, now this heat has already risen, so this joint, the next joint, the outlet, is already preheated. So we check it to see how we have. Look at that. It's preheated enough, it pulls the solder right in. You want to wipe, make sure you don't have any excess solder. You'll keep trying to run out of that bottom one. Again, the heat has risen. It's pretty much preheated this upper joint. We just barely touch it. And we see it flows. And then we make sure all the way around. Okay. And we wipe it while it's still liquid. And you do not want to bump it while it's still setting up. You'll break your joint. So once you get a joint completed, we can move up to this one, being very careful. Okay, now we're going to complete and do the upper one. As you heat, we preheat the pipe. We want to go around, all the way around if you can. On a smaller bore pipe like that, it's not as critical. Larger bore, it is very critical to preheat. Now, we've already wiped the flux off when we started, but as we heat it, the flux starts running. Gravity will pull it down, and we'll get some, the solder will follow that down. So we heat now to the insertion point. On the lower one, it's going to take the majority of the heat. We can see it pulls right in. Okay, now the upper one has already been heated. It just take a little bit of heat. You can see it already transferred up there. Both sides. Okay. We make sure, as we can see, the flux keeps running. We want to wipe and be gentle with it as it's cooling. At this point, we do not need any more heat. You finish soldering, so you want to wipe down any excess flux. And at this point, we are now ready to drive home these isolators. Take your hammer. Finish your installation off. And there you have it. Do not hammer these in until you've let this cool for a minute or two. Otherwise, you will risk breaking these joints. They're fragile at this point. They will let go.
Home Improvement Camp. Have at it.